This is Babette Babich, and I've been asked if I would re-record a Zoom keynote that I gave on the 13th of May, 2020. That was for a meeting of the Society of Women in Philosophy in Spokane. That would have been at Gonzaga, thanks to an invitation from Trish Glazebrook and Roisin Lally. There was a whole day of talks, and it's really tragic that they're lost, but the individuals in question have been asked individually to come up with some various homemade versions of a re-recording, and this is that. Now, the title, this background here, is obviously not real. This is just the title slide. But I'm not really going to be presenting by means of my Zoom background, and it's not going to match. So it's like the clock on your computer or your iPad, your iPhone. It may change with the time, but this will not change. Still, that is the very first slide. I joke and say that I'm at the Winchester Extension. That refers really not to the Winchester Extension of Spokane, but to the fact that I'm there. And although Fordham has a London program, they have for years not sort of agreed that I should teach in their London program, although I live in Winchester, which is just a little outside of London. And lo and behold, this last semester, I have been teaching from not the Fordham University in London, but at least to Winchester. Sort of Fordham University in Winchester. The title, Love Actually, Logic and Misogyny, and Analytic Anger, or the Other Side of hashtag MeToo. I'm going to begin. This is the talk I gave. I'm grateful for this invitation. There's, of course, another slide. I could have used that. Virtually Spokane. I tweeted to be sure that I wished it had come earlier in my life so that I might have had the real life chance to visit Spokane, as in fact, I've long wanted to go there. You can see that I'm not making this up. Check the second tweet, I had my reasons. Wanted to get the t-shirt. When Roisin invited me to give this keynote for the local meeting of the Society for Women in Philosophy, I took her invitation as an invitation to talk about women in philosophy, actually. Now, the last time I did that, I tend to sometimes be too literal, was when the grad students at the New School, down some distance down from Lincoln Center, and asked me to give a talk. I surmise their first choice declined because the invitation came at the last moment. The lecture series was on, I was told this, the status of women in philosophy. So you can see this is right there, PSWIP. Right, that was second annual colloquium. Same acronym as SWIP. I could, of course, have spoken on Nietzsche on truth, which I'm good at talking about, or Heidegger and technoscience. I also write on that. And I was very grateful to have been able to hear Matthew Kubler-Ross and Trish Glazebrook, who spoke on Heidegger and techno-related things, and Roisin on ontogenesis, although she gave a creative new talk, and so it's tragic that that was lost. So then, too, I could have talked on anything. I mean, anything. They really were just inviting someone to hear from. But instead, I gave the kind of paper one gives when the conference one thinks one is speaking to is about a certain thing. This is in my mind, status of women. So my title was Great Men, Little Black Dresses, and the Virtues of Keeping One's Feet on the Ground. I was talking, nobody's really wearing high heels there, but I was talking about high heels as ladies wear these, or they used to, for a night out on the town, as opposed to the more relaxed affair that was then and is now Saul Kripke, or, and this is the other thing, Jean-Luc Marion's bow ties, that's a significant other male choice, and Simon Critchley's t-shirt couture. This is significant. I write about this in the Hallelujah Effect. It's actually a research theme for me. Love Actually, that was that slide I almost went to, is the title of a Christmas movie. I use the film, I talk about the film, to talk about philosophy and about the importance of distinguishing analytic philosophy, which otherwise tends to pass for the whole of philosophy from other types, like maybe continental. By contrast with Stanley Cavell or Robert Pippin, both analytic thinkers, I refer to film in the way that Plato used to refer to the poets for the sake of his arguments, citing Homer, and Pindar, just as Aristotle could also talk about Archilochus. The references were cliche enough for both Plato and Aristotle that neither Plato nor Aristotle explicate their loci. Classicists have a lot of work to do just because of this. And older philosophers once upon a time, just think of Northrop Frye or Leo Strauss, Northrop Frye if you're Canadian, Leo Strauss if you're anybody, everybody else, or Max Weber, that's an older reference, or even Nietzsche, still older, might refer, perhaps, among other things, in addition to classics, to the Bible. Alternately, there's contemporary literature, and Simone de Beauvoir's The Second Sex is full of references to literary texts a fair number of us haven't read, for reasons not merely limited to the fact that most of the literature she happens to cite is French. I have sometime been arguing that one should read between Beauvoir and Nietzsche, and not only because writing on the woman in love in The Second Sex, she cites both Byron and Nietzsche, or because she echoes Nietzsche's claim in Ecce Homo that it was men, Nietzsche says, who invented woman. Beauvoir echoes that. Indeed, I have argued that the famous first line of the second volume of The Second Sex, on ne n'est pas femme, on le devient, one isn't born, one becomes a woman, alludes to the line Nietzsche himself borrowed for his own part from the 7th century BCE lyric poet Pindar, become the one you are, which for Pindar means that you ought to be what you are. Genoi hoios esi maton. In a few essays elsewhere, I have made the case that the lion has a specifically imperative foreskin eye. Nietzsche turns this into what becomes philosophical gold. This is the very idea of giving oneself a second nature, being for oneself, one's own mother, one's own father. As Nietzsche writes in Ecce Homo, as my father, I am dead. As my mother, I am still living and growing old. That's, of course, true for me in this case, so it's a little painful. Tracy Strong has written on occasion about this notion of giving oneself a second nature, as have others, and Ecce Homo was very influential for Sarah Kaufman, who gave 2 seminars on this book at the Sorbonne. For Nietzsche, what's involved in becoming what you are, or was that the ego? I'm never sure. So people who are Kaufman experts do not give me grief about this. For Nietzsche, what's involved in becoming what you are is just what philosophers hate, what philosophers in search of fixed and static notions in order, excuse me, there we are, that's right, in order to argue a proper case. I'm in between 2 different slides and it's not working. And that's becoming. The problem with becoming, where's not becoming, is that you're soaking in it. They're like Madge's dishwashing liquid. Very few of the people who were attending the Zoom meeting were really old enough to remember the television commercial reference. Not everybody is Rosie O'Donnell, but David Foster Wallace stole the point for his This Is Water and got away with it, because who would think a brilliant and tragic male author might owe anything to a commercial about 2 ladies talking? De Beauvoir, for her part, also goes on to quote, and this is a major focus, Nietzsche on death as a festival. Borrowing the quote from Georges Bataille, the new translation of The Second Sex has a range of regrettable deficiencies it shouldn't have had, and fails to tell us any more than partially does that Beauvoir's citing Bataille. Even the German translation fails to identify the locus of de Beauvoir's Nietzsche citation. This is problematic if you're looking for it, because you really can't look it up. We're keen on the next new thing, and de Beauvoir's old news, at least when it comes to questions concerning women in philosophy, who really writes about this. But to my mind, she's worth writing about because she goes deeper. And it's this depth which enables no one less than Lucy Rigorai herself to borrow the title of marine lover of Friedrich Nietzsche from this same chthonic and antediluvian locus, the very one I'm talking about, with reference to Bataille and Nietzsche in de Beauvoir. As de Beauvoir writes, Mother Earth has a face of darkness. She is chaos, where everything comes from and must return to one day. She is nothingness. herewith. She refers to Hesiodic myth, as well as to Anaximander's Periphuseus via Theophrastus, and of course via Simplicius, his Apeiron. She, as counterpoint to Sartre in being, de Beauvoir writes, is nothingness. The reference is one Nietzsche explicitly quotes from Goethe's Faust to speak of the mothers of being in The Birth of Tragedy. De Beauvoir, also referencing Goethe, tells us, I now quote, that the mare tenebrarum dreaded by ancient navigators corresponds to night in the entrails bowels we have here of the earth. This is the mystery locus of death, Thanatos. And de Beauvoir writes that the human being, mihishi, meaning the male, meaning man, is frightened of this night, the reverse of fecundity, which threatens to swallow him up. Beauvoir had explained the patriarchy's oppositions in clean language. Life, she says, in man's eyes, has taken on a dual aspect. It is consciousness, will, transcendence, it is intellect, and it is matter, passivity, immanence, it is flesh. Aeschylus, Aristotle, and Hippocrates proclaim that on earth, as on Mount Olympus, it is the male principle that is the true creator, form, number, and movement. And you have the loci there, if you like, in addition, of course, to play at Parnassus. The reference is Pythagorean. But that takes one back in de Beauvoir herself to Backofen and Mutterrecht. Nietzsche talks of the fantastic dream that is the dream of immaculate perception. That is, the philosopher's hatred of becoming, we already saw that, entails, as this does, becoming, procreation, growth, but also sickness, but also decay, death. So de Beauvoir, there we are, right? Okay, good. Writes, to have been conceived and then born an infant is the curse that hangs over his destiny, the impurity that contaminates his being. And two, it is an announcement of his death. The cult of germination has always been associated with the cult of the dead. The earth mother engulfs the bones of her children. They are woman, the Parcae, the Moirae, who weave the destiny of mankind, humankind, but it's they also who cut the threads. In most popular representations, very important here, death is woman, and it is for woman to bewail the dead, because death is their work. But one reflection of love, death, life, death, tension, as women represent both things to men, and indeed, because every woman has a mother, I already referred to mine, who's still lives, and grows old like me, to women alike. And man at once wants to live, but longs for repose and sleep and nothingness. He does not wish, I'm missing a word here, he were immortal, and so he can learn to love death. Nietzsche writes, inorganic matter is the material, maternal bosom. To be freed of life is to become true again. It is to achieve perfection. Whoever should understand that would consider it a joy to return to the unfeeling dust. Now, I made an error about the maternal, but the whole point's just, no matter what errors you make, complicated. Because this is a strange thing to say. This doesn't seem the Nietzsche of will to power, or the Übermensch, which, undoing a century of scholarship for some strange reason, the new Stanford edition translation, Zarathustra tells us, means superhuman, superhuman, superman. One sense is that the translators really wanted to say superman, but the editors in the dictionary held them back. Is this Nietzsche, the celebrated philosopher of life, talking about death as a festival? Already, however, in another context, in the last public, real public lecture I gave, a very interesting topic, of course, on the concatenation of double twos. That's why I couldn't resist it at the Brooklyn Public Library at 2 in the morning on the 2nd of February 2020, long night of philosophy, sponsored by the French Embassy in Brooklyn Public Library. The Bataille locus is uncanny, as everything Bataille tends to be. It appears in Asphalt, the quote from Nietzsche, January 1927, the year Heidegger publishes Being and Time. Part of the quote echoes the conclusion of Nietzsche's inaugural lecture at Basel, where he reminds us that the ancient Greek philosophy comes out of the sedimented remains of nothing but a death cult. To quote Paisley's earlier version, to be freed of life is to become true again. It is to achieve perfection. That would be that same thing we just read. Whoever should understand that would consider it a joy to return to the unfeeling dust. Same quote, just different rendering. But this isn't quite what we find in Nietzsche's Nachlass notes. To be redeemed from life and to again become dead, nature, tote natur, can be regarded as a festival for those willing to die. To love nature, again, to honor the dead. It's not contradiction, but the mother's womb, the rule that possesses more sense than the exception, inasmuch as there is unreasonableness and pain merely, only, in the so-called purposeful world, in the living. Bloß bei der sogenannten zweckmäßigen Welt, im Lebendigen. So it's only there that you have your problem. What Nietzsche means by dead can give us insight into Beauvoir's archetypical constellation. Speaking of what we today can buy, you can still do this if you can go shopping, and these days as things are opening up a bit, at Whole Foods as cell sorts in his Nachlass, which is what we're really quoting. Nietzsche, there's the cell sorts, goes on to write how alien and superior we are with respect to the dead, the inorganic. And all the while, we are up to 3/4 of a length of water. The German is eine Wassersäule. And have inorganic salts in us, which may do more for our well-being, he really is talking about the cell salts, and woes than the entirety of living society. Now, I tend to read Nietzsche as philosopher of science and classicist at once, both, as he happened to have been. And it's the same Nietzsche, the very same Nietzsche, that de Beauvoir invokes. He says, she writes, man, the human being, sought to overcome his solitude by ecstasy. That's the goal of mysteries, orgies, and bacchanals. Obviously, this is Nietzsche, the classicist. In the world reconquered by the males, it was, this is de Beauvoir, a male god, Dionysus, who usurped the wild and magical power of Ishtar, of Astarte. But still, they were women who reveled madly around his image. Maenads, Thyades, Bacchantes summoned the men to holy drunkenness, to sacred fake, sacred frenzy. And you can see the sacred frenzy there, very sacred, very frenzy. Now, I have another section. Section 2, take 2, logic and misogyny, and analytic anger, or the other side of hashtag me too. The trouble with my title, apart from having conceived it in a bygone time, before any of this happened, BC, before COVID, is that it really needs what we academics call a trigger warning. Not logic, not misogyny, not love actually, and certainly not the comma, which is for me the best part, nor indeed the hashtag, me too. The trigger is the word analytic. My hashtag me too moments, classically conceived, are legion. I think that applies almost to everybody. But these moments change in all stages of a woman's life, harassment by no means being limited to the sexual per se. Thus, hashtag me too, as I gave a talk in February 2019, that'd be the February before the last one at the Brooklyn Public Library, so wait, no one had any idea of this, to the faculty at Fordham, of philosophy, or love actually, speaking across the disciplines, as one should, in such interdisciplinary circumstances, I discussed 2 Emma Thompson films, the title reference also featuring Alan Rickman, along with The Children Act, about a judge. I recommend people, if nothing else or better to do, this is something, certainly a better thing to do, about a judge played by Thompson herself, who saves a boy played by Finn Whitehead, foregrounding the futility of such medical measures. It's actually a very relevant film, to use the language physicians use, and which Ivan Illich writes about, inasmuch as medical interventions even those ordered with the force of law, which is what she was about to do, do not actually effect what medical advisors claim they will. Thus, Thompson's church fails to save the boy. And this I foregrounded. There's a lecture, as well as when the Los Angeles Review of Books published my interventions. There's also a little brief discussion of that, this Children Act. In addition, almost as if she's anticipating the current social distancing, she also seeks to avoid, absolutely, and I think that I argue that's her moral failing, any contact at all. Her failure to respond to his overtures almost spares her any suspicion of harassment. I say almost because the bar for this is absurdly low when it comes to women. Being stalked, it can be supposed that she is to blame. The boy being younger, beautiful in the sense of true and open youth, captivated by nothing less than a line of poetry. Yeats, no less. Thompson sings down by the Sally Gardens to the boy in hospital as he picks out the song on guitar in his hospital bed. Turns out he had no idea the tune had words. As she learns of his fading life, she sings it again before crashing her own piano recital, damned as she is, either way. To mention this is crucial. Post-coronavirus, visiting the sick, anyone at all, this is, after all, the fifth corporal work of mercy, is today criminalized. But before COVID-19, I was concerned with language as such. The sound of word, noting the foul sounds of Thompson's judge speaking to the sick boy in hospital, the I followed by a rounded A and O in life and love. In any case, the English professors who heard me like the talk, my colleague Frank Boyle, Milton and Swift specialist, along with colleagues in theology, psychology, political theory too, and the high point for me, that's why there's this slide, Mary Bly, the Mary Bly, who happens in her spare time to be a New York Times best-selling novelist. I'm not kidding, because of course I'm a great fan. I cannot pass her in the hallway without being awestruck. And she raised a question about my talk in response on love, on responsibility, and what we owe the other. Her question, of course, made the talk a success, as I thought. I thought that when Professor Bly asked her question, and I thought that until everyone left the room and I alone in the room was approached by a colleague. I didn't think anything of his approach or that we were alone in the room. I'd known him since he was hired, been on his side as he came up through the ranks, took his side actively so, through his tenure challenges. Caught off guard, I saw that he was livid. We have this word in English, his face red with anger, spitting his rage, accusing me of saying something I hadn't said. Analytic philosophy, he says, I said, causes sexual harassment. Now, analytic philosophy has a good deal to answer for, but I would never say and do not believe that analytic philosophy causes sexual harassment. So I told him, but he wasn't listening, as he went on to say damningly that he had heard this from two of my colleagues, both junior at the time, telling me their names. Then he stalked off. I don't know where to begin with my distress. So, of course, I told my dean, I told my chair, etc., and was invited, as one always is, this is a sucker punch, to file a formal complaint. But I've been through that and know how the deck is stacked and know that it's not stacked in favor of a woman whose complaint is that she's been the subject of malicious calumny, poisoning, what else does it mean, collegial relations. It was a mess, and I was left, as I have to work with him. Does this sound familiar? Yeah, to clean things up. No one spoke to him about it. Not a word from anyone in administration, even though I spoke to my chair and so on. Instead, it felt to me to reach out to him. That's what they wanted me to do, so I did. Talk about emotional labor. I did this not for my sake, but for the collective good, and above all, for the students, our students. The first line, that's why I have the slide here, of Kate Manis' introductory chapter to her Down Girl can sound odd, even for a philosophy book on logic, especially for a philosophy book on logic. Women, she writes, who are strangled, rarely cooperate with the police. manner has an inline reference right there telling us this is analytic style, flagging the point, almost social science citation style, that this is a fact, parentheses, that's how we know. Resnick, 2015. She then explains that such strangling is often incorrectly called choking, only to tell us of the long-term physiological effects of a violence to the body that often, to the great advantage of domestic abusers, from time immemorial, do not, quote, leave a mark. Manner has another inline reference, parentheses, Snyder, 2015. Phenomenologically speaking, Merleau-Ponty tells us that anger is interesting among the affects. And here's a slide. I would have cited it. It really is here, in this room, this is Merleau-Ponty, and in this part of the room that anger breaks forth. It is in the space between him and me that it unfolds. I would accept that the sense in which the place of my opponent's anger is on his face is not the same as that in which, in a moment, tears may come streaming from his eyes or a grimace may harden on his face. Note the stylistic difference between Manner's analytic style, with her parenthetic references, and the style of continental philosophical psychology, which is, of course, also Merleau-Ponty's training as a scientist, social scientist. Anger is, Merleau-Ponty says, between us, immediately perceptible in the other, even when one has no idea what the other is angry about. Thus, after my talk, I saw my colleague's anger. It wasn't just his inflamed face red with anger. That's a phrase where the color goes with the subject, in this case, the affect modified, like rosy fingered on with a wine red sea. It is anger Kate Manner talks about. To talk about the same for my part, I draw not only on Merleau-Ponty, I've just done that, but also Achillicus, who was, as Horace says, armed with anger, dipped in iambic, Achillicum proprio vabies amavit iambo as. That's the next line, it's not on the slide. It's a great phrase, and we hear anger rage in the first lines, as it is the very effective, a cause for the protraction of the battle that was the Trojan War, as we read in the Iliad, key as this was for Plato. And then there is Aeschylus's Oresteia, and the terrible fallout of anger tracked through Sophocles' Antigone. I've managed to anger more than a few analytic colleagues, and some continental scholars as well, simply by talking about all kinds of things, because I tend to talk about rather a lot. I've already done that in this talk. But my analytic philosophers, friends, colleagues, can be upset because I just mention analytic philosophy. Elicited not by use, but mentioned, that is, again, simply by talking about the difference between continental and analytic philosophy, I should say what used to be continental philosophy. Nota bene, because this is important, that I'm not talking about history just to the extent that history of philosophy, the term, is an analytic rubric. I don't do history of philosophy, for example. And the difference, as I've tried to already stress, between analytic and continental is a matter of writerly style and context. Think Merleau-Ponty, think, of course, Kate Manner. If I continue to think that there's a difference between analytic and continental philosophy, that difference long ago became Leibniz style, a difference, apart from this last question, that makes no difference. This isn't because the only thing that matters is doing good philosophy. A hopelessly vague assertion, but because analytic philosophy is all that's left. This includes those who take themselves to be continental but pride themselves on being informed by analytic philosophy. And you better be so informed, because that's the only way to get a job. I think I pointed this out in the last talk at the end, because if you have a formation and you can talk about all these things, this doesn't mean you're also continental, it means you're analytic and call yourself continental. analytic philosophy is factically characterized very often by a certain Leiter-esque nastiness, contra those it supposes shouldn't be heard and ideally should not exist, especially if they have the temerity to mention anything like, much less give papers on, the difference between analytic and continental philosophy. I'm talking about this here, this paper that I was invited to give as a keynote for SWIP, because it's a climate issue. Bad for women, bad for philosophers who do continental philosophy and double loss, especially if one does, as I do, philosophy of science the hard way, by focusing on Nietzsche, whose philosophy of science consists in questioning science and pointing out that there's no truth. And I have a third essay in this essay. There's several sections, and I always think of them as separate essays, and they kind of are. You can break them off, and because this is a Zoom thing, you perhaps you've already left and given off, but if you haven't, you could break here and come right back, and or we'd have another clarification, resuming the theme again. Nye, that's Andrea Nye's, words of power, manners, that's Kate Manners, down girl, and Hobbes, that's Thomas Hobbes, de corpore. Both Andrea Nye and Kate Manners speak of logic. Nye, in her 1990 Words of Power, a feminist reading of the history of logic, and some 30 years later, Manners in Down Girl, almost, the logic of misogyny. Manners doesn't cite, doesn't seem to have read Nye, but both authors are analytic by formation, as this is what happens to be taught in most graduate departments of philosophy in the UK and Ireland, in Australia, the US, Canada, also at, I mean, at Fordham, certainly what we teach. And also, I happen to have a book on this in France. Where's my book? I can't find it. No, maybe I have a slide later. Anyway, the book on this in France and Germany. The ambiguity comes in because as soon as I mention analytic departments and suggest that your department might be one, or else that you yourself likely took your degree from such a department, no sooner do I do that than everyone morphs into the philosophic equivalent of those who counter the hashtag MeToo movement, which is of course the reason for the hashtag MeToo movement, with the hashtag not all men response, so hashtag not all departments. And then I'm still counting the ambiguities, because to talk about philosophy as the love of wisdom, the stuff the president of Ireland has gone about saying that there should be more of, entails, logically speaking, a discussion of equivocation inherent in any discussion of philosophy, whereby everyone assumes that everyone means by philosophy just what they themselves mean, all the while, as it turns out, which is the reason I mentioned philosophy as taught at university, and analytic philosophy is particularly egregious in this, they will take all the claims concerning the benefits of philosophy to be claims concerning analytic philosophy. At the last Heidegger conference, it's important to mention this because Roisin herself was the secretary convener of the conference we should have been having for the rest of the current week, post EU to this event, and she was there, as was Trish and Matthew Kruger-Ross, as well as Gilles Druyard, who was also at the SWIP conference, and other fellow Heideggerians. I tried to talk, I have to say tried to talk, because I failed. In Rochester, I fail fairly frequently. I gave the same talk in Meskirk in German a week later, and it went marginally better, but only because I was talking to psychiatrists. But Heidegger's Misogyny, instancing Heidegger's medically focused Solokon seminars, we required details like Heidegger's misogyny, his love affairs as distractions. So too, what wines Heidegger liked, his taste in hats and ski wear, because logicians know that such matters shift focus in the point of logic, truth conservative as it is, should teach us to be unswayed. Thus, referring not to Heidegger but Frege as anti-Semite, we know that we're not talking his logic. Thus Frege scholars and be inclined to defend Frege, inasmuch as antisemitism is irrelevant to understanding Frege's logic, or Heidegger's being in question, you could also argue, and the point holds as logic depends on bracketing details for the sake of form. Likewise, in analytic ethics, all debates on advantages and disadvantages, the calculation, just as Heidegger says, of tossing or not tossing a fat man onto the tracks in the path of a passing trolley in the so-called trolley problem, depend on the same logical irrelevance. In fact, no one is throwing anyone, regardless of girth, anywhere. Ergo, the man and his life, no matter whether Frege or Heidegger, is irrelevant. So to Searle, so to others, and there are quite a few, charged with this or that offense when it comes to misogyny or sexual harassment. So it may be argued that we ought to attend solely to the substance of philosophy, to what was written by Heraclitus, say, or Heidegger. Lived, he died, that kind of thing. And yet the problem with this line of argument is that it is unbinding. It does not hold. I've already referred to Nye's Words of Power. Nye's project is evident in her subtitle, which you can barely read here, A Feminist Reading of the History of Philosophy from Parmenides to Frege and so on. Nye's Words of Power was badly received among its analytic reviewers. Still, it offers a valuable articulation of the force of distraction in logical argument. Nye undertakes a hermeneutic, which she doesn't name a hermeneutic, as she reflects on the contextual content of Quine's, there we are, methods of logic. For his part, Quine selected his propositional examples partly for the neutrality, names like Smith and Jones, and no less for the triviality, that is, the substantive content of the examples is stipulatedly non-remarkable, to wit, to be present or absent, healthy or ill, for the express sake of illustrating formal relations of entailment, their incongruity. Thus one can say, for a statement with eternal truth value, to cite a certain logical chestnut, if the moon is made of green cheese, here we have this line, I am a Dutchman. Or, waxing eloquent on equipollas, we can cite Hobbes' variation on man is not a stone, followed by man is not a tree, followed by man is not a pear tree. So to recall Quine, the truth value of the compound is not determined simply by the truth values of the component statements, but by these in company with further considerations, and very obscure those further considerations are. On the other hand, the truth value of the conjunction, Jones ate fish with ice cream and died, or the alteration, Jones ate fish with ice cream or died, or of the negation, Jones did not die, admits of no dispute whatever. Once the truth values of Jones ate fish with ice cream and Jones died are known individually, and you can make a truth table and calculate that. That is great fun. Nye wondered why such a constellation of relevance, irrelevance would hold. Although knowing that the formal sense of logic is a matter of distending to details in favor of the truth's functional form of propositions, knowing that the more purely one thinks of the better, Nye wondered why Jones was so very often ill, as he repeatedly was, and why, if only because the conjunction demanded it, Smith so very often away, or why Jones would eat fish with ice cream, and more curiously, having a done so, why this would be conjoined with his death. Sorry about that. More significant in Nye's discussion of the history of logic is not her recollection of her tutor's presumption. She talks about this. There may have been some version of harassment there. Maybe not sexual, but certainly logical harassment. Maybe he suggested her strengths lay elsewhere. But her Frege chapter, A Thought Like a Hammer. The point, she argues, her book is logically written, traces the compulsion of argument whereby the point of logic is preserving truth, maintaining one's claims, forcing one's opponents to yield. The technical force is the point of logic, and philosophy continues to value the same power, not of persuasion, compulsion, proof, demonstration. The other side of Me Too concerns the detail that the expectations men have concerning women are not limited, and not limited to what devotees of romantic novels can refer to as sexual favors. Beauvoir, this is one of the reasons today's feminists say she's unkind to women, uses the language of the deal. In fact, she writes, women may fail to lay claim to the status of the subject because, as de Beauvoir writes in her introduction, she lacks definite resources because she feels the necessary bond that ties her to man, regardless of reciprocity, and she's often very well pleased with her role as other. And this complicity is part of the reason some find difficult to read The Second Sex. This isn't helped by the fact that the new translation is as technically terrifically awful as it is, a tragedy given the high level of de Beauvoir's writerly style. In truth, de Beauvoir's only repeating Rousseau. Marriage is an economic contract with corporate benefits. This is why gay marriage is so important. She's right about that. The anger question already mentioned is part of this analytic continental male-female who gets the jobs, the question of male rage, resentment, anger, which, to be sure, de Beauvoir also notes when she speaks of the views male students have with respect to the prospect of competition from women. Right? Every woman student, she writes, who goes into medicine or law, she's quoting a male student, robs us, the men, of a job. The rage hasn't diminished, and it is what was said to me 33 years ago when I was first on the market and managed to get a few interviews whereby my colleagues promptly nodded, faculty and grad student alike said, friends these were, it's because you're a woman. That was surely correct. And in my case, no one then and no one now would be looking for someone writing on Nietzsche's aesthetics and epistemology as a bona fide theory of truth, much less philosophy of science. Beauvoir pointed to the same entitlement point that Mana takes up, not referencing Beauvoir, she doesn't do that, except in passing, the male students in question never once reflected on why those jobs might belong to them. He never questioned, as Beauvoir writes, his rights in this world. This goes without saying, and it still does. The other side of me too is the silent question, the question that can come to be raised only after one has become invisible when walking in the world, as Wallace Stevens writes in his Old Age. Not that Stevens, poet laureate, was ever actually invisible, except where it mattered, and that was very important to Stevens in his own poetic mind. So one goes from the margins, I used that language in 1996, twice over if you write on Heidegger's, Trish will also confirm, double that if you at Nietzsche, exponentially intensified if you're trying to do philosophy of science, technology, what have you in that fashion. To invisibility, I have lived this in a lifetime. If the hashtag MeToo is all about the culture of harassment that can shadow a young woman's career, this also shows up in teaching evaluations. The studies show, and the anger, I had terrible evaluations, of course, it's even worse on Zoom. But students are not as fond of female teachers to this day, same semester. And Deborah Tannen reminds us, objectively, just by measure, prefer the same content delivered by a male instructor over the same content delivered by a female instructor. Hashtag MeToo is about coming clean, not merely in support, but in acknowledging how very frequent, how very common, to the point of near ubiquity this culture can be. The other side of MeToo is what happens when you age. Things do not get better when you pass to the invisible. And in an age of COVID-19, where the aged have acquired the status of lepers in the world, the vulnerable who are regarded as those who should be locked up, literally self-isolating, as all of us are, just to be safe, just to be sure that in case you are ill, you will not infect others. And to be sure, that's also what happens as a consequence, that you silently weaken your own immune system, right? Because the only thing that can strengthen your immune system, apart from the standard things your mother might have told you, vitamin C, echinacea, golden seal. The golden seal, it's interesting to note, is the most valuable herb we know, thanks to Native American herbal medicine, but also garden variety dirt, walking around in the world, going up and down in it, quoting the poet Archibald MacLeish of the generation that lifts the Bible. I talked about those at the beginning. The anger towards women is, so Mana tells us in Down Girl, a matter of expectations, which, as she tracks these through her analysis of misogyny, can be seen as a corollary of control, such that misogyny could be attendant to patriarchy and its discontents, particularly with respect to expectations structurally defined by the same. Mana is invoking, this is all she needs to speak of such expectations, no more than some women's social roles in a patriarchal culture as in men's attentive, loving subordinates, assumed by right, such that the result is anger, when these expectations are not met. In the case of young women, the expectations can be tend to be erotic, and this is one side. I'd like to say the first side remains with Me Too, hashtag Me Too. The other side, as I'm speaking of this, it's a continuation of that same entitlement expressed as an expectation in Kate Manner's analysis of support, appreciation, admiration, etc. When this isn't forthcoming, or not forthcoming as expected, the result is rage. And more than we might suppose, so Beauvoir argues, so I'm arguing, age is a problem here. Writing in 1949, the examples de Beauvoir gives mention women of 50 as old, of course, but only to make the point that a man of 50 is ready, as she argues, to begin his professional prime, rising to the highest positions, the most important jobs, and that's not going to be the case for women. Her observations remain relevant, as is her contrast with men, given that in him, the passive qualities of an object are not called for. The changes in his face and body do not destroy his attractiveness, whereas well before she's in any sense old, woman is haunted by the horror of growing old. Not only that, but her age as such is often strangely male-defined, such that as 41, she was 41 when she published this text, de Beauvoir is uncompromisingly blunt. She's still relatively young when she loses erotic attractiveness and still has about half of her adult life to live. In 1886, I wasn't yet 30, living between Brussels and Paris and avoiding Jacob Talbot's very continental harassment, that's what he used to do, when she, de Beauvoir, died 6 years and a day after Sartre's death in 1980. She died in 1986. We don't like women when they get old. We like them even less when, if they get uppity. Think of the outrage contra Germaine Guyer, who's only saying in her old age the sort of things she's been saying all her life. Charming once, it is so very offensive now that there are calls to ban her from speaking engagements. I know she says the wrong thing on the wrong topic at the moment, etc. But is this because she's wrong? That'd be another talk, and I'm not writing about her work or what she says. I'm only writing about rage, academic as it is, that would exclude her entirely, because uppity turns out to be whatever we say it is. I have for conclusion, PC post-COVID-19. Above, I refer to death and to the complex myths with which de Beauvoir begins the second book of The Second Sex. Here, I could ask, you could ask, have I just given an entire lecture just to say that there is no there there? In some part, yes, I have. Anger is, as Mann says, a grievous thing because it is as widespread as it is. And news reports tell us that with lockdown, we are now living through and beyond post-lockdown, a little open lockdown, certain type of lockdown. We could look back and count the deaths and count the statistics to know that it has led to a predictable increase, fatal and otherwise, in incidents of domestic violence. Because of lockdown, one is also, this is a complicated aspect, without recourse, as this is part of the hashtag MeToo, part of the same hashtag deal, you could add, to use de Beauvoir's language, if we can get it hashtag. When Geraldine Finn wrote, Why Althusser Killed His Wife, and All You Need Is the Title, she was going against the grain in political critical philosophy by suggesting that such a detail as that fact ought to matter to us in Althusser's case. This is part of what I suggested might be relevant when it came to Heidegger and his misogyny, the garden variety, ladies man style of misogyny. That's what I talked about at the Heidegger conference last time, last time it met. That gets a pass when it comes to singers and poets like Leonard Cohen, Hallelujah, and all that. But age brings a different array of entitlements and expectations when it comes to men. And it's noteworthy that we've already shifted to regarding the aged as outcast. I had some slides on that. Expendable, another word for vulnerable. as we return in law and public health to policies that used once to be called fascist and still are, under the terms that we are now living in. As a man of words, misogynist hostility can be anything that is suitable to serve a punitive deterrent or warning function, which, depending on your theory of punishment, may be anything aversive to human beings in general, or the woman being targeted in particular. I've been arguing that what Manu describes only increases with age. That's the other side of me too, hashtag. If I can't help but take a step back to Beauvoir in closing, it's because she suggests that all of us, including, might be part of another take, another parsing of that other side of me too. This is the logical amphiboly, whereby men might come to value as effectively, as erotically, quite as women do. That's that incredibly fantastic erotic generosity that my good friend Deborah Brogan found. Lovely book. De Beauvoir, an existentialist and thus no essentialist, offers a word of optimism for this account of the other side of hashtag me too, suggesting that many of us are already there. If men, she writes, would be willing to love an equal peer instead of a slave, as it must be added, do those who are at once free from arrogance and without an inferiority complex, women would not be as haunted as they are by a concern for their femininity. They would gain in naturalness and simplicity, and they would find themselves woman again without taking so much pains, since after all, that is what they are. So, 1908, 1996, I want to just thank you for your attention. This is the talk, Stop Action, Logic and Misogyny, and Analytic Anger. Or the other side. Me too. Hashtag me too.